In 1952, within Mexico, an explosive volcanic eruption would occur that instantly wiped out an entire subspecies of animal. Before I tell you more about this eruption, to get you interested in this story, let me show you that eruption's aftermath with the vastly expanded San Benedicto Island as it stands today. Even 73 years later, the 335-meter or 1,099-foot high and 1.2-mile-wide tuff cone which was constructed remains essentially lifeless, with numerous erosional troughs descending from its crater rim. In its central cone, and on its southeastern side, very pristine albeit long ago cooled trachyte lava is present, which is a type of highly viscous molten rock typically associated with highly explosive volcanic eruptions. Thin vegetation, primarily grasses, have since returned to the northernmost half of the island, transported there by the many seabirds which now inhabit this island once again. On July 31st of 1952, the San Benedicto Island, 410 kilometers south-southwest of Cabo San Luis in Baja California, looks something like this. It had an estimated population of 20,000 seabirds, of which at least several hundred were subspecies of the rock wren known as the San Benedicto rock wren. This subspecies was completely unafraid of all mammals, including humans, and behaved differently to its land counterparts. However, magma was at the time rising underneath this volcano, which owes its existence to the mantle plume of the Socorro hotspot. Like Socorro Island to the south, San Benedicto Island was constructed on a 3.5-million-year-old mid-ocean ridge-spreading segment which became inactive as the plate boundary several million years ago shifted notably to the east. Thus, as the overlying tectonic plate moves, the Socorro hotspot occasionally sends molten rock into the crust, which is naturally thin at this extinct mid-ocean ridge, acting as a path of least resistance. One of these eruptions began without much warning at 7:45 a.m. local time on August 1, 1952. As building pressure beneath the volcanic edifice became too great, a powerful explosion occurred, generating a white and black colored eruption plume that quickly rose to an altitude of 10,000 feet. The energy of this explosion was amplified by the overlying ocean water, however, part of the eruption plume was too dense to rise on a buoyant column of hot air, so it collapsed back to the ground, generating a series of pyroclastic flows. These pyroclastic flows incinerated everything they touched, wiping out all vegetation and birds present, immediately causing the extinction of the San Benedicto rock wren. They then continue to flow into the Pacific Ocean, traveling up to 3.5 kilometers or 2.2 miles away. Across the next 11 days, near-continuous explosive activity occurred, depositing multiple meters thick of ash from the greatly fragmented trachyte magma. Surge-sand explosions eventually caused a brand new tuff cone to rise above sea level, expanding San Benedicto Island to the south. This tuff cone then continued to quickly grow in size, while at the same time the eruption became slightly less explosive due to less of a magma-seawater interaction occurring. By the end of August, this cone had grown to be more than 250 meters tall, with the effusion of a small viscous lava dome occurring in its central crater. Explosive activity continued to get weaker as the days progressed, although the newly formed tuff cone continued to expand. Then, on December 8, 1952, a volume of trachyte lava pushed its way towards the southeast of the new cone, breaking out and then flowing down slope. This then built a lava delta with an area of about half a square kilometer. Activity at the slowly growing trachyte lava flow subsequently declined, and by mid-February this eruption, which read on the Volcanic Explosivity Index as a 3, had ended. While we do not know the age of San Benedicto Island's older vents, I have made an educated guess as to the order they formed in, with the lavas associated with progressively younger components becoming more evolved over time. I interpret that a torulon formed first from trachybasalt to basaltic trachyandesite lava, with its red outcroppings being owed to the higher iron content in that variety of lava. Cerro Lopez de Villalobos erupted next, producing basaltic trachyandesite to trachyandesite lava flows that create a lava dome. The Roca Challenger trachyte dome formed next, followed by the crater Herrera, which, while technically a lava dome, this merely marks the less eroded interior of what was likely once a large tuff cone like seen to the south. As a final note, I would like to thank my new patron, Eric Johnson, for supporting this channel.